gonna come out sideways. Hello, friend. Question. Am I sideways or can you see me? Like, straight up and down. If I'm like tilted sideways, let me know. It's just the way I have my camera, but I can flip it. So somebody let me know. Sideways. All right, we're flipping it. Thank you. I can do this without breaking anything. Friends, just getting my camera fixed because one of my good friends told me I was sideways. There we go. Is that better? We're good. So for those of y'all who are joining, thank you for being here, crashing the Small Town Society Instagram live page tonight. My name is B Spoke at the Poet. And I am super excited to be here with y'all this evening. Thank you, Small Town, for having me. Hello. So, I used to live in the Bay, but I live in Atlanta now, so it's like 11 o'clock my time here. So, I want to thank you all for coming out. I want to thank Small Town for inviting me. I want to invite my boyfriend, Chris, for staying awake to rock with me this evening. So, we're going to just listen to like a few more tunes for just a second, and then I'm gonna get started sharing some poetry with y'all. Is that cool? Anybody ready for some poetry tonight? Yo, what's up? And because it's so lovely and a chill evening, I hope you all came in ready to kind of just like vibe out and relax. We're going to treat this like it's just like a good like group chill out session. We're not going to be super performy tonight. I'm just going to share some musings and some thoughts with you guys, and we're going to chill tonight. Does that sound okay? All right, so like I said, my name is Brittany Williams. I go by B Spoke at the Poet. I'm a writer, spoken word artist, performer. I used to live in the Bay, and now I live in Atlanta. I moved out here just right before COVID to be closer to my family. But I'm super stoked to still be connected to my small town family and still get to like do vibey things like this with you guys. So I'm stoked to be chilling with y'all this evening. I think we got about maybe half an hour or so. So I'm going to do a couple of pieces for y'all. And like I said, we're on a real chill, just kind of family vibe tonight. Oh, wonderful. Thank you so much. I'm glad you remember me. Yeah, we're just going to all like really chill out this evening. So I'm not going to be doing like a, you know, spoken word performance kind of deal. We're going to be doing more of a kind of storytelling session. So I hope y'all are ready for that. Before we get started, I know like I'm on a screen here and you all are on a screen there, but I want us to feel connected. So everybody just take a deep breath with me. Take it in. Hold it. Let it out. Relax. Breathe in all the good vibes. Breathe out every concern, every stress, every worry. Breathe out your whole Wednesday. Good deal. So yeah, I am going to do a couple of pieces. I'm going to start with one that's kind of heavy because I feel like it just kind of speaks to the time that we're in. I wrote this piece a couple of years ago, after witnessing the, it was like an arrest of a guy who, I don't know what he did, but it was around the time when, you know, black men were being arrested and killed, and it was a really scary time. And I was at my job and I saw this guy just kind of standing on the sidewalk in handcuffs. And I was really curious, like, why he was standing there on the sidewalk, what he had done to, you know, to earn the ire of the police in that moment. And then I remember thinking that it really didn't matter what he did. It was just a really dangerous time for him to be, you know, a black person in this particular space. So I wrote this as my own reflection of what I felt like he may have been experiencing in that moment. So this is called He Stands on the Sidewalk. He stands on the sidewalk. People keep walking. Some stop and ask the cops questions while he stands there, hands behind his back, cold metal turning warm as sun and sweat meet at his wrist. His pockets are turned inside out from the search. His long locks blow in the wind. It's been calm today, but suddenly with the commotion of the moment, the wind has decided to add its blustery flair to an already chaotic scene. He's still standing there, slightly bent over. His shoes have been removed. People are still stopping, still asking questions, still wondering if this has something to do with the events of the past week, wondering if their safety is in question. I watch him. I watch them, the sea of black and blue uniforms, lights flashing, multiple law enforcement vehicles for this one person. He's just one person carrying an entire population. The reputation of all who bear his likeness rest on his shoulders, the shoulders of just one person, invisible to the passersby, who see him and skin as threat. Their fear transform his human into justified dismissal of his humanity. Funny how fear of ghosts keep turning men like him into them without cause. How the suspected label of criminal suddenly makes him a part of the sidewalk to be walked on. As he stands there, I still watch him from my tower, like guardian angel, ready to swoop down in his defense should any weapons be drawn. It won't matter what you did to draw the attention of suspicion in your direction. It won't matter if this is legitimate or another case of just being black in America here. Every mix with law enforcement and black skin could be the end of your life and the birth of a movement here. In God we trust. But American justice means you probably won't ever see any. But I see you. I see him. And I watch him with heart full of dread and head full of names and faces. News media displays as the latest casualty in the war against blackness continues with another turned hashtag. I too am afraid, afraid that his life may end as score for the other side on that sidewalk. I look at him and I see every black man I have ever loved. Every time I was not the watcher or the passerby, but the sister of the one standing there, the aunt and the cousin of the one standing there, the mother, the grandmother of the one standing there, hands up in prayers to God for the ones standing there. Prayers that our prayers be bulletproof, make black skin impenetrable, that our watchful eyes and raised voices remind those passersby that he breathes the same air that they do. He stands on the sidewalk, and I wonder what he's thinking. Do they know that he is thinking something, feeling something, and that he too is afraid? Thank you. I wrote that piece a couple of years ago. I was working, I used to work for Google, and I was on my way to the YouTube campus when the whole shooting broke out. And so, they really heightened up security after that. And then anyone who looked any the least bit suspicious got detained by the police. And it just happened. It just felt like every person that I saw get detained by the police was a black person. So I felt the need as a black person who was welcomed into that space, because for some reason I didn't seem like a threat. I felt the need to process my feelings with that piece in that moment. But I hope you enjoyed it. I'm going to shift to something a little bit more, a little bit, I won't say more thoughtful. They're all thoughtful. I, along with poetry, I also write short stories. I turn my thoughts and musings about life into just stories and poetry. And sometimes I'm writing in my journal and my random journal entries will come out like poetry and I just kind of go with it. So this one I wrote on the plane a few weeks ago. I was on my way out to Colorado to do some work with some friends of mine who live out there. And a little bit of my background is, thank you, Crazy Three Sid. I appreciate that. Or is that Three Kid with a C? That's pretty dope. I am a millennial in my early 30s, running away from corporate America after spending several years kind of in that space, decided that I needed to free myself from that space. And with that freedom has come a lot of amazing things, and with it has also come a lot of fear and a lot of questions and a lot of, oh, this whole time. Can you guys see me? It froze for a second. I think I'm back. Let's see. I think it's all right. I can't really tell. Can you guys see me? Can somebody wave at me if I'm still working? Anybody? Okay, cool. Thank you so much. Thank you. Okay. So yeah, along with, thank you. Thank you, Brian. I appreciate it. Along with, you know, this freedom of, I quit my corporate job and I decided to follow my dreams, comes the fear of, oh crap, I quit my corporate, secure, safe, steady paycheck of a job to pursue my dreams of being an artist. What am I doing? And I've been writing and processing my feelings a lot about that in forms of poetry and journal entries and things. And this was an entry I was writing in my journal once I landed that turned into this really poetic piece I thought was thoughtful. So I would like to share it with you guys. It's called Turbulence. And here we go. The plane shakes violently for more than a comfortable minute, and I am knocked from the bliss of sleep. The kind that feels like receiving some eternal reward at the end of an odyssey. Well done, beautiful. You made it. War-torn weather garment aside, my first thought is that maybe death will be quick and painless, unlike the life sentence of being forced to survive. A baby not more than 3 sits in front of me, negotiating the cloth mask he's been asked to wear. He doesn't understand germs yet. And if this plane doesn't stop shaking, then he may not ever have a chance to. He might never have to shift from innocent child to lost adult. A college professor once told me to find my way quickly while I was still cute. Everyone wants to love a puppy, he says. But grown dogs never leave the shelter. They turn needy with mange and misfortune. No one welcomes them into their space. And it's funny the messages that we internalize. The ones that stick to your bones and grow with you. The words we struggle to grow out of, be careful what you let stick to you. As a young one, full of promise and lacking not enough experience with letdown, I never imagined myself in his description. And as the plane threatens to send us tumbling from the glory of 10,000 feet, I wrestle with whether or not that would be such a bad thing. We talk about those who die young as if they are the greatest tragedy. But we do not cry for those who die. Sorry, we do not cry for those who struggle to live, for the lost grown-ups, the strays who were once full of prime and promise now roaming the streets of existence with a world on fire around them and the doors to all the safe houses shuttered. Maybe death could rescue these before they suffer such a fate. Before they become the 30-something wondering, unsure of what's the next step of life after flunking out of corporate America. Before they become the dreamer who's reduced to surviving. Before they become the burden on society no one thinks they will become when they are so damn cute and cuddly, just puppies. Maybe we can rescue them from a fate that makes death look like Disneyland. The fate of living lost in a world who cares little for the wanderer. and post few wayfinding signs for those looking for such a way. The plane stops shaking. The three-year-old says in a quivering yet curious voice, "Dad, what was that?" His dad looks at him reassuringly. "It's just turbulence, son. Nothing to be afraid of. You're okay." Thank you. Hi, Paul. Good to see you. Yeah, so like I said, I wrote that piece just kind of musing on my way to Colorado to do a few weeks of volunteer work, some artistry, just kind of figuring out some of this space that I'm in. And I was really struck by this moment of, I was telling my boyfriend about it earlier, when the plane started shaking, my first thought was, oh, if we fell out of the sky, would that be such a bad thing? And then I was like, oh my God, why did I have that thought? And the answer was because I was feeling a little bit lost in my own life at the moment and wondering if anyone sees that. And then I started wondering if there are other people who feel this lost and if there were more ways for us to figure this out. So I hope you enjoyed that one. I'm going to take it a little bit lighter for you for these last couple of pieces. So I have always been the kind of person who... Oh, before I go into this piece, let's all take a deep breath because we just tucked in a couple of heavy pieces. Thank you. Yeah. Chris is like, appreciate it. Breathe. Let's take a deep breath all together in. We processed all that heavy stuff. And now we're going to take a deep breath out. Relax, 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 relax. Cool, cool, cool. Do we need one more?
I think we're
good. Chris, you think we're good? Chris thinks we're good. We're going to keep going. Okay. So I tell people when they ask me, how did you become a poet? I was like, well, I never set out to become a poet. I was just the kid who needed a really healthy way to process the turmoil, the chaos of life. I've always felt things really deeply, processed things really deeply. And then rather than turning to, you know, unhealthy forms of therapy to cope with life, even as a young person, I decided to write poetry. So I write about whatever moves me, whatever strikes me, whatever inspires me, whatever pisses me off, whatever makes me sad. I write about whatever brings me joy. I write about all of it. And when I was in high school, I had the biggest crush on this guy because his smile seemed to be this answer to questions that I didn't quite get. Yeah, same here. In the boat at the moment. Yep, I feel it. Yeah, I'm so glad. I'm glad this is how you found poetry. That's wonderful. Keep going. It's not only just a beautiful form of therapy for yourself, but for other people when you share it, it's a healing thing for everyone. So I would totally encourage you to keep going with your poetry, for sure. But yeah, so there was this guy in high school I had a huge crush on, and something about the way he smiled just made me feel like he had figured something out about life that I didn't get. And I really wanted to figure out what he knew. At the time, what I realized now as an adult is that I was really drawn to his positive energy and this just carefree way he walked through life. But what that manifested itself as a teenager in high school is, oh my God, I love you so much. And of course, we did not get together because nothing in life ever works out like that, which is totally fine now because, anyway, it's totally fine now because I met a really great guy and probably gonna be together forever, so whatever. Anyway, move.
Sorry.
So I wrote this piece though because July 23rd was this guy's birthday, and he popped up on my Facebook timeline, and the first thing I saw was that smile that I looked forward to seeing in school every day, and it inspired this poem that I wrote for him called July 23rd. And it's not, I didn't even really write it for him. I wrote it as a reflection of who I was then and who I am now, almost like a grateful to be here piece. So awesome. What's up? Great guy. Oh, Paul says to say hi.
Hey, Paul.
So I hope you enjoy this piece. And I would encourage you often to look back on your own journey and the things, even the smallest things that kind of carried you through certain seasons of life that kind of brought you to where you are now. And that's what this moment of reminder of this guy's smile was for me, just to look back where you were, think about where you are now, and be grateful for that really small thing that carried you to here. So this is called July 23rd. His smile was the sunrise, my alarm clock, my wake-up call on a Monday morning where there is no good reason in my mind to be conscious. Not when I had his smile all to myself in my dreams, but in the hallways of Morrow High School, his smile was no longer a dream, but a real-life glow I could bask in for a few minutes on the way to class. A real hope I looked for on the practice field. The reason I went to practice in the first place. Georgia Heat takes no prisoners, and the Southern High School steppin', high-steppin' drum majors take no sympathy on the weak. And his smile, making all the heat and ridicule for poor posture at attention worth something to look forward to. He was joy wrapped in black skin, thin and walking through life as each step paid him royalties and he owed them nothing, but gave back anyway. Grateful for the blessing of breathing the same air I couldn't wait to hide from every day. He was all smiles, and I was all questions, thinking his hope was a mystery. A code he cracked with ease while I struggled to find my own set of keys to the same locks. He thought that I was too sad, that I didn't smile often enough. I thought I lacked the understanding of all the good he saw in life to stroll on his road with the same confidence. But we just didn't know who I was yet. That it takes me a little bit longer to open my eyes in the morning. That the sunlight hurts my eyes first thing in the morning, but sometime around noon, I feel like living. I put on my sunglasses and live. With my shades tinting the world a different kind of beautiful, not the same rose-colored kind he sees, mine a little more of a gray tint, but still beautiful. The things I write about now and turn into poetry are the things he would say that I thought too much about. He would say that these things brought me down, but today I fly on those things. I still think too much. And I still feel too much, and his smile is still beautiful. It's still the sunrise. God bless the sunshine state for keeping him warm and God black glowing. I remember whole hallways made ice frigid and frozen by the air of high school mundanity. Every day a winter storm blowing in a blizzard of chaos and drama of who stole whose boyfriend and what gang was gonna get together to throw down after school. But his smile brought spring in early, made flowers grow through the thick snow of hopeless teenage days that drug on, took too long to end, broke my heart into millions of pieces that words and time have put back together. Remembering his smile makes me remember that special girl in the hallway who did not know that she was a flower that just grew differently. But she knows now, and so grateful for July 23rd, for giving me a reason to write today and to smile. Thank you. So yes, I encourage you to go back into your past and find the small things that maybe then made you cringe. Like when I think about the kid I was in high school, I'd be like, ooh. But I'm so grateful for that kid now because she is the reason I became who I am. And I'm thankful for that very small reminder. Thank you. That small reminder that I'm grateful to be the person I am today. So I got one more for you. Thank you, Paul. That I kind of wrote on the same vein. I was feeling that whole inspiration of smiling and being joyful and all that jazz. When I wrote it, I had not officially quite totally started dating my guy here. And we've been friends for a long time, but we didn't know we liked each other until like a month ago. So I was musing about, you know, how it felt to like be in love with someone, to crush on someone, all the inspiration that brings. And just kind of how it makes your life feel a little bit different when you are like crushing on somebody or whatever. And for me, I don't know about any of you, but for me, when I'm in that space, I feel all the things, all the joy. The sun shines a little bit brighter, you know, it's all this, there's deeper feelings and meaning and like something as small as, you know, this soy sauce packet. I don't know why this is here. But feeling in that space, and it's funny because I'm feeling it now because I am, you know, in love with someone, which is great. But at the time I was remembering what it felt like to feel this way about this person in school and all these reasons to smile. And then remembering that I am my own reasons to smile, but sometimes you need to be reminded. But something about love makes you feel like the world is a little bit better. And that's kind of what this piece is. It's called Smile for Me. And again, it's just my musings on what it felt like to be in love, missing that feeling of feeling alive, grateful to have it now. But maybe for you, it's not the feeling of feeling in love. Maybe for you, it is a really awesome taco that makes you feel that way. That makes you feel like, oh, I am alive. Maybe it's doing something you love, like writing. Writing does do that for me, too. It makes me feel like I can get up and do this every day, any day. But this last piece, I hope you find, you know, the joy in that little thing that you do or have in your life that makes you glad to be alive. So this is called Smile for Me. I miss the wobble in my knees when your teeth part lips and spread open. Lift cheekbones and wrinkle skin underneath the eyes. Squint eyes just a little bit when it's natural. I miss the skip in my chest, watching you light up the room with your face, glad for the gift of living and ready to pass it on to anyone in need of saving. I miss my heartbeat. I was so aware of my heartbeat whenever you were in the room. Worried you could hear it from across the room. Worried you could interpret the Morse code signal singing from my ribcage. The adrenaline rush of imagining what you would say if you could. I miss the breath catching in my lungs. Forgetting to free itself and make space for the next. The lightheaded feeling of a daydream production sponsored by the possibility that you might just speak to me today. That you might smile a smile that only belongs to me today. Yesterday, loving you made me feel alive. Today, I miss the feeling of feeling alive, of looking forward to sunrises and sets of monogrammed mugs. An engraved reminder of changed last names and two forevers mixed together like hot milk and cocoa. I miss the dream world I walked in imagining the life your smile could unlock. I've forgotten that my own smile is a key. I want to learn how to use that key again. Yay for tacos, Paul. Yes, 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 yes. Good. Yay for smiles. Yeah, yay for smiles, reasons to smile. And I hope you all have found tons of reasons to smile today. And I hope that this poetry gave you a few more. And I hope that I will get to see you all smiling again. Again, my name is Brittany Williams. I go by Bespoke at the Poet. You can find me on Instagram at Bespokeit. That's BSPOKEIT. You can also follow me on my website, which is bespokeitpoetry.com. Very simple. You can follow my blog there as well. And keep an eye out for a new podcast that I'm going to be hosting. Yes, Paul, I will save it this time. How do I save it? I'm assuming it's probably this send arrow button. Let me know if that's for real, if that's how I do it. Yes, you can follow my blog. Keep an eye out for my new podcast that's getting ready to start called Black Girl Sticky Notes. I'll post about that when we get ready to launch our first new couple of episodes. You can also, thank you so much. I appreciate that. You can also follow, another podcast I've done called Bay Street. That one is on hiatus for now, but keep an eye out. There is constantly new things rolling out of the Bespokeit machine. So when you, it will ask you. Oh, okay, cool. Cool. I will definitely hit yes to the save. So again, I hope you all have enjoyed this session with We Spoke at the Poet. Looking forward to doing it again. And I'm going to send you all off to the sounds of Flowetry. I hope you all enjoy. Take another deep breath with me. In. Out. I hope y'all have a wonderful evening. And I will see you next time. Oh, so glad. I miss you too, Paul. All the time, bro. Thank you for all the West Coast love out here on the East Coast. We need it. Yes, indeed. Down to rock with you anytime, my friend.